Good morning, everybody, and welcome to worship. Please sing with us.
Hallelujah. to wide open spaces, graces, waiting for a clue. Dance like the weight has been lifted, graces, waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. Oh, the Spirit is here, let there be freedom, let there be freedom. Bring all of your burdens, bring all of your scars. Spaces, graces, waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, graces, waiting.
Thank you.
You're not far away, you're coming close. And oh, even as I wait, you're coming close. You're like starlight in the dark. Smiles can't conceal you, and every glimmer is a spark, catching fire as you break through.
Let's pray. God, thank you for meeting us in this place. Thank you for being present in our lives. God, as I pray, just continue to pray for breakthrough in the lives of folks in our congregation and breakthroughs in this world. God, where there is hopelessness, provide hope. Where there is restlessness, provide rest. God, thank you for every single person who's gathered here this morning. In your son's name we pray these things. Amen.
Good morning, church, and welcome to worship. A huge thank you to everyone who helped out at our drive-in service last Sunday. It was so wonderful to see so many of you there, and we're actually thinking of trying to do another one in August. So let us know what you think about that. Let us know how we can improve that experience for folks. But it was so, so, so wonderful to see you and to gather together and feel like we are actually a part of something bigger than ourselves. Remember that we're not alone in all of this and all the things that are going on in the world. So thank you, thank you, thank you for the wonderful experience last Sunday. A quick reminder to please let us know that you are here, that you are watching. Let us know how we can pray for you and connect with you by filling out our digital and virtual connect card. We will show a QR code now, and I'll make sure to throw, if you're watching live, throw a link into the chat box. Well, last week at our drive-in service, we started a new series all on the book of James, this epistle entitled after a guy named James in the very back of our Bibles. And it is a book all about faith in action, saying internal faith and an internal faith life is not a complete experience of faith. We need to be living out our faith. Jesus Christ came here to show us how to be in the world and how God wills us to be in the world. And that has everything to do with being followers of Christ in action, in word and deed. So we are going to continue on that sermon series and that walk through this very, very short book. It's about 5 chapters. So please go read it. It's in the back of your Bibles. And I think you will really, really enjoy it. So friends, James is speaking to this group of new Christians. There's a lot of leeway in when people and scholars think that this book was written, but we're probably in the first century, right? The first century AD or CE. And we assume then that Christians, all of these new baby Christians, all of these folks who've just committed their lives to following Christ in the world and yet have no real examples of what that looks like, not too many at least. So we're talking to folks who are also experiencing diaspora, right? They're living out, they're kind of being pushed out of their communities and living in exile. They are feeling isolated. They are feeling tested, like they themselves are being tested, like their faith is being tested. They are desperate for that wisdom, right? That wisdom that we can finally gain when we go through these things that feel like tests, when we experience hardship, right? And James talks about how faith gains endurance when we are experiencing hardship, right? Because when we're in the midst of things that hurt and experiences that hurt and change around us that make us uncomfortable, we have no choice but to examine our faith, right? And hone our theology and make sure that our theology matches what we are experiencing in our lives. Does that make any sense? I hope it does. Think about big events that you have gone through in your lives, times of significant trial, right? And for how many of us is that a huge faith experience at the same time? We learn so much about ourselves, we learn so much about God, and we learn so much about our relationship between ourselves and God. And so James is speaking to this community who feels like they're being tested, people who are living in anxiety, right? They are stressed out, their faith is being tested and stretched perhaps for the very first time. Remember how new this faith is, right? And so these faith muscles are like being exercised for the very first time as they ask themselves, how are we going to make it through this moment? How are we going to make it through this experience of hardship that they are sitting in and living in right now? And so the wisdom that James has for these baby Christians, for this Christian community living off in exile, right? Living in isolation, living in oppression. He says, do not underestimate the utmost importance of that love your neighbor as yourself, golden rule that Jesus told us about. Think about faith. I mean, there are lots of things to consider. There are lots of ways that we picture expressing faith, right? There are lots of rituals. We go to church. We baptize babies. We receive communion. We have these rituals of reading scripture, of praying. And yet he says, while those are all important, do not forget how often Jesus showed us that loving our neighbor as ourselves is a critical piece and part of our faith. Yeah? And for some of us, we might be sitting and hearing that and being like, well, duh, right? Like, why is that? Why does that even need to be said? We know that as followers of Christ, we're meant to go out and be kind to people and be generous to people and be merciful, right? We're supposed to go out and be good people in the world. And especially if we're experiencing hardship, like those new Christians were that James was talking to, why does this need to be repeated? You'd think that people in hardship would naturally kind of band together, right? And care for one another. We've seen that happen in the world. Perhaps we've experienced that ourselves. But I guess according to James, this is not necessarily the case. This new uncentralized church seems to be floundering as they sit in the space between the way life was, right? Before this oppression, even before Jesus, how they were able to succeed and survive, the way life was, and the way life is now. How to survive and succeed in the world as it is now, and how to succeed and survive in the world that God in Christ is trying to build. Amen? And so he sets out a very, very simple example to try to help these Christian communities grasp this and grasp just how elusive it is and how easy it is for us to lose track of this imperative to love our neighbor as ourselves. So we're going to jump into the second chapter of the Epistle of James. We're going to read chapter 2, 1 through 13. So let's read together. My brothers and sisters, when you show favoritism, you deny the faithfulness of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has been resurrected in glory. Imagine two people coming to your meeting. One has a gold ring and fine clothes, while the other is poor, dressed in filthy rags. Then suppose that you were to take special notice of the one wearing fine clothes, saying, "Here's an excellent place, sit here." But to the poor person, you say, "Stand over there," or "Here, sit at my feet." Wouldn't you have shown favoritism among yourselves and become evil-minded judges? My dear brothers and sisters, listen. Hasn't God chosen those who are poor by worldly standards to be rich in terms of faith? Hasn't God chosen the poor as heirs of the kingdom he has promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor. Don't the wealthy make life difficult for you? Aren't they the ones who drag you into court? Aren't they the ones who insult the good name spoken over you at your baptism? You do well when you really fulfill the royal law found in Scripture. Love your neighbor as yourself. But when you show favoritism, you are committing a sin. And by that same law, you are exposed as a lawbreaker. In every way, then, speak and act as people who will be judged by the law of freedom. There will be no mercy in judgment for anyone who hasn't shown mercy. Mercy overrules judgment. So James is pointing out just how survival works, right, in the world that these Christians are living in the society and the culture that currently exists in their lives, right? Survival in this world means how well can you climb a ladder, right? How well can you participate in this system of judgment? Who is below you? Who is above you? How well do you rank among your peers? And James tells this community that this leads us to evil-mindedness. He points out that turns out being Christians and following Jesus will mean a significant breakaway from this way of being, from this way of understanding success, from this way of living and surviving within the status quo, right? So James asks us to take a super critical look at society and cultural judgment in which we exist, right? And the way that we are allowed to judge one another, right? The way we justify judgment towards one another. And he doesn't really get far in his example, right? He points out a very, very simple, he lays out a super simple example. He says, imagine two people show up to a meeting, right? Doesn't tell us what kind of meeting, doesn't tell us like who was invited or who wasn't. It's just, hey, imagine two people show up to a gathering. Two people show up to a gathering of people. And he points out right away just how easy it is to judge one another. We judge each other and we value each other differently. And we live in a society that perpetuates that, that teaches that, that tells us that as long as we do that, that's the only way that we're going to be able to succeed in the world around us, right? We judge each other and we value each other differently. And turns out that's hard to notice when you live and are steeped in a society that justifies all of that, that normalizes that kind of behavior. We've been talking a lot about systemic racism lately in our world, in our nation, in our church, on our Sunday mornings, right? And there's a group of people who are reading that book, White Fragility, with me by Robin DiAngelo. And I'm gonna tell you, friends, that reading that book and doing that internal work of noticing my own behavior and noticing my own biases and that internal work of exposing my own complacency in the world, complacency within a system that judges and values people differently, friends, and how often I do it and don't even notice it, right? And that alone is embarrassing and it's vulnerable and it feels like shame and it feels like guilt. And yet that very act of noticing what society around us normalizes, of noticing just how I do judge and value people differently, how important that work is. Because I can't change and I can't be different unless I notice those things about myself. We can't change, we can't be different until we notice and face those things about ourselves. Amen? And so James is asking us to do the very same thing, asking all of us, all of those new Christians, to take a critical look at the iniquities that surround us, to notice them, and then take action. He goes on to say that this internal noticing, right? This internal work must result in external work. He goes on to say in chapter 2, my brothers and sisters, what good is it if people say they have faith but do nothing to show it? Claiming to have faith can't save anyone. right? Imagine a brother or sister who is naked and has never had food to eat. What if one of you says, go in peace, stay warm, have a nice meal? What good is it if you don't actually give them what their body needs? In the same way, faith is dead when it doesn't result in faithful activity. Faith, according to James, faith should lead to change. We should be choosing mercy over judgment. And that is hard to do when we live in a world that survives and is put together and functions through judgment of one another. Amen? And I want us to think back about how God has shown us and started this work within us, right? God did not just say from above, oh, I love you, and sit back and then do nothing. God showed us and shows us what faith in action looks like, feels like, is like in Jesus Christ. And Jesus showed up then and showed us what faith in action looks like. And it wasn't ladder climbing, friends. It wasn't to make sure that he could afford to wear all the nicest things or that he could have the best seat in the house. Jesus showed us what God's kind of kingdom looks like, what God's action, God's agency is trying to build in the world. And instead of climbing a ladder, it looks like lifting up the poor. It looks like freeing the enslaved. It looks like demanding and acting for change for those around us, for those who have been judged and pushed down and low. And friends, this switch, without question, as Jesus taught us, comes with a cost. Amen? Surviving and succeeding in the world and the culture and the society around us is not the same and doesn't look the same as surviving and succeeding and living in faith. It requires us and asks us to build something new, to desire and want something new, something closer to what God has envisioned for us and for creation. And so I wonder, as we read through this book of James, as we consider what our call as faithful people is in the world right now, when we are experiencing anxiety, when we are experiencing stress, when we are seeing over and over just how different people are judged and valued, I wonder what's holding us back from doing that work, both internal and external. I want you to ask yourself, and I'm asking myself, what are we holding on to that stops us from being able to truly act in faith, right? To truly follow Jesus no matter the consequences in this life and in this world. Are we afraid of being judged? Is there entitlement that we are hanging on to? We think that as people who have done X, Y, and Z, we deserve a certain kind of life and lifestyle, no matter what that means for those who don't have those things, right? I wonder if we are afraid of what this change and transformation will mean for us, what the consequences and the cost will be. I wonder if we are afraid of having our shame exposed, right? Like I said, doing that internal work, friends, it is not pretty, but it is necessary. And it is a part of following Jesus. So friends, what is holding you back from acting, from being followers of Jesus in the world? From taking your faith beyond reading scripture and coming to church on Sundays and saying prayers before meals? How are we acting in the world? How are we showing faith in the world? How are we creating God's kind of change and transformation in the power of the Holy Spirit in the world around us? Friends, this is really hard work. This is really hard internal work. This is hard external work. It takes blood, sweat, and tears. It takes effort, and it takes energy, and it takes commitment. And it means letting go of the way things were to say yes to the way God desires them to be in our lives. So in the midst of this faith stretching that we are doing, in the midst of a time where there is so much pain and anxiety in this world, and we are called to be followers of Christ in it, to make change, to bring transformation, to share the good news of Jesus Christ, how can we be assured that God's love is here for us, that God is companioning us in all of this, in every breath, in every step, in every heartbeat, in every effort that we have to make change? And how can we be reminded once again that loving God and loving our neighbor as ourselves is truly what is going to set us free, is truly what is going to bring us to life, is truly what is going to make change, lasting change, real change in this world and in the world to come? How are we being called to be followers of Christ today in such a time as this? Let's pray. God of love and God of grace, give us holy, holy, holy courage to follow you, to be Christ-like in this world, to let go of the things that feel safe and secure, the things that feel like survival. Help us let go of these things and grasp onto your truth, to your truth of mercy, to your truth of action, to your truth of fellowship and community and life in you. Thank you for your love and thank you for your promise, O God. Forgive us for when we fall short. Forgive us when we can't muster the courage to let go of what was. Continue to call us forward, God. Continue to offer us opportunity after opportunity, day after day, moment after moment, second chance after second chance to be followers of Christ in this world, to share your love with our neighbor and to know your love in ourselves. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus the Christ, our brother and our savior, and all God's people said, amen.
Suffering, silent casualties, oh God, grant us
friends, now is our time of offering. So we will show you a QR code that will take you to our giving page, and I'll make sure to throw a link in our chat box. But I do invite you to give. I invite you to experience God's kind of generosity. And may we be changed, and may the world be changed in it and through it. Amen.
Oh, heaven comes to fight for me. Sing a little louder.
friends, may you go from this place of worship to the next step and the next moment where we have the opportunity to worship our God, to love our God by loving our neighbor as ourselves. May you go from this place with God's kind of holy courage and love. May you go from this place to share and to act upon your faith. May you go from this place knowing the love of God, the grace and mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the peace and power and agency of God's Holy Spirit is within you. Go from this place to love and serve the Lord. Go from this place to grow in your love of neighbor. Go from this place and follow Christ. And all God's people said, Amen.